focusing on this weekend. And it reads, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations." What a beautiful psalm. It really just encompasses everything that we focus on, not just this weekend, but it's just highlighted this weekend. One of my favorite verses is Galatians 2:20. And I'm happy to be able to share that again with you this morning. I know it's been mentioned throughout the weekend as well, because it is pertinent and it applies, and it just kind of continues to build upon that fact that God repeats himself to make it clear to us. And it really just goes in with that, not my own theme. And it reads, "I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." As I looked into what it takes, what a devotional is, and how it should be delivered, because I had not done one to this point, I'd like to know what others say or what others do. And as I looked, as I spoke to people, and as I researched it, I found that it doesn't really have a standard. There is no simple template that we can follow, and I kind of like that, because it really leaves it open for just yourself to come out through it. And the goal really is to inspire and to provoke. That's the goal of a devotional. So if you would bear with me and permit me this morning, I'd like to proceed in kind of a story format and put it into something that really comes out of my own experience, if I could say that. So I remember a time from my youth, from when I was growing up, when my family attended a church in Akron and Jacoby Road. Later on, when I was about a teenager, we started and we built another church on 94. So that was my growing up experience with the church. And several families attended there. It wasn't very small, and each family had multiple children. I'm the middle of seven children, and I would have been considered a medium family at that time. You don't see that in this day and age as much. But this, of course, with all those children, all those families, that size, it provided an opportunity for us to have a great group of guys and girls that were really tight-knit, and we spent as much time together as we could possibly muster. So it didn't matter whether we were getting into trouble, gathering for singing at someone's house, singing into the wee hours of the morning. I know many of you were partakers of that as well. Didn't matter what state you lived in when you traveled, it happened. We did that after church on Sunday nights, and we just sang into the night. We would travel hundreds of miles in a five-car caravan, go from Ohio to Windsor just to visit an older sister who was in a nursing home or in their home, confined there, just to spend time with them. And basically doing good and bad in the same breath, because we were doing what we were kind of taught to do, but it wasn't something that we were doing in the service of the Lord. And on the way, who knows what we did, got into, or discussed. But the point is that we were inseparable as a group. And I'm sure that most of us here have had a similar or relatable experience on a smaller or greater scale. That's kind of the culture that we grew up in. So we fast forward to adult life. The years that many of us are in right now started perhaps a decade ago, a year ago, 5 years ago, whatever it might be. But our friends are not there anymore to join us in our escapades. We would go out, or you go out, and you start to cause those troubles. You turn to celebrate with your friends, but they're not there. You go to the movies on Saturday nights to do your little movie hopping. I'm sure that's not something that was just that I did. It's confession time, right? But you do your movie hopping, and you go and you turn to high five that successful hop, but your friend is not there to reciprocate on that. You're just left hanging. It's frustrating because you keep inviting your friends. Now, the premise here is that your friends have gone and gotten married. You no longer have them with you because they're somewhere else. So they've gotten married, and now you're going through all these motions, and they're not there. You keep inviting that now married friend to join you, and you're frustrated because they keep declining your offers. Yes, what changed? Why would your marriage change who you are and what you do? Why can't you do the things that you used to do with me? We could do those together still. You could always go back to your spouse. They'll be waiting for you. But ultimately, I know when I got married, I didn't get married to spend time with my friends. I did that already. That chapter of my life was over, at least in that extent. It was a new chapter in life. There was a newfound focus in life. So these scenarios, although a bit exaggerated at some points, they're all parts of my real life experience. And I'm just hoping that they'll help to illustrate really the point that is in line with the theme for this weekend. You see, when we get married, we make a commitment to our spouses and to our children, if God would so choose to bless us with them. They become our priority. They become our primary focus. Their well-being, spiritually, physically, that's our goal. That's our objective. That's the direction that we go in at that point. We belong to our spouses, and they belong to us. We become one, as Scripture describes and tells us so clearly. We don't have time, nor do we have the desire to do or be who we were before we entered into that marriage. There isn't much room for it, and it doesn't edify the family unit. So we can look back at this little story, and we can reflect on it. And we can reflect on the theme of "Ye are not your own," and we can substitute pieces of it. We can substitute the friends for our relationship with sin. We can substitute the marriage with the new relationship that we have with God through Christ. So when we were young, we had an ongoing relationship with sin. It was with us everywhere. We went, and at any time, even when we were in worship services on Sundays or in gatherings, sin and I were inseparable. We did everything together. At school, he was there. In the car, he was there. He was at every party. He was at every church gathering, in every pew for every Sunday service. He didn't care where it was, as long as I took him along. The time came when I heard the call of Christ and devoted my life to the Lord. Now my focus shifted. It shifted from the friend called sin to the redeeming relationship I now have with Christ. Sin went on as usual, causing trouble, but I wasn't there to embrace him. Sin went to movies Saturday nights, but I wasn't there to revel with him in it. Sin got frustrated, continued to call me and invite me back. But I didn't enjoy that life anymore. There was no longer any room for him in my life. There was no longer any joy in the company of this friend called sin. Sin asked me, what changed? How has this new relationship changed who you are? Why can't you just come and do the things we used to do together? And then when we're done, you can go back to Christ. He'll be waiting for you there. I had to tell sin that he was a detriment to the new life that I have in Christ. And this new relationship has a value that is far superseding the old one. I now belong to Christ. I'm no longer my own. I do not walk according to my own will and desire, but to the will and the desire of the Father. I'm crucified with him, Christ, the Son of God, who liveth in me, loved me, and gave his life for me. I love him because he first loved me. I am not my own. No, not any longer. And I find pure peace, comfort, and joy in this simple truth. Amen.
Let us close with a prayer. Bow our heads. Our great loving God, which art in heaven, we're humbled to be communing with thee now and thanking thee for so many blessings. We thank thee for this message this morning that made the hairs on the back of our neck stand up, this allegory, this story where we could put ourselves right there and we see the beauty of that intimate relationship. We see the beauty of that open and transparent relationship that thou wants with each one of us. This is our Sabbath day. This is our day of rest, our day to identify with 6 days of building and now resting. So we've regenerated our souls. We have ammunition from great spiritual topics. And we just pray that those who are considering, contemplating, who are still on the fence, that they would feel that loving hand being extended and that they would turn to thee. We pray for that marriage relationship, that intimacy, which would come with only Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Please, God, look into our hearts. Correct us as we ask forgiveness, as we look to be with thee and have holy communion with thee. So please add to this prayer. Please be with us the rest of this day. And we ask all things in Jesus' name. Amen.